Sunday. And again, I want to welcome you, but just want to say right out from the beginning just how bizarre this is. Getting ready for this, speaking to an empty room is just something I've never done before. So we thank you for being a part of it. We thank you for being here this morning. A few things that we want to give you in terms of announcements. So that you sort of know where we're at, what's all going on. The easiest announcement that I can make is that most of the stuff on our calendar for the rest of the month of March is postponed or canceled. So we are doing just a live stream service this Sunday and next Sunday. We're not sure yet what April holds. There are some who think this will extend through April. There are some that think we might be able to get back to some sense of normal that first week of April, but we're not sure. So we will keep you updated as we go. But in terms of meetings and things like that are going on at the church building, all that stuff is canceled. We just don't want anybody coming by or groups meeting, things like that. So we're going to try our best to keep up in terms of information. First and foremost, we're going to ask you to do a few things. If you want to get more information from us or make sure that you are on our mailing list, all of that, if you would send us an email, send that to info@paradisechurch.org. You can send us a message through Facebook, you can send us a contact form through our website, but all of those are great tools to make sure you're staying up to date. I will point you to our website. If you're watching us on our website, obviously you're there, but if you're on Facebook or something like that, I'm going to point you to paradisechurch.org. On that site, you can get an updated version of our calendar, all of that information, resources that you can use as we continue through this season. Despite all this that's going on, it is still it's still Lent. It's still the season that is leading us up into Easter. And so we want to still be able to sort of feed your spiritual journey as we go through this time together. Especially if you have needs. If you have needs or prayer requests, if you could make use of that that email address, the info@paradisechurch.org, or feel free to give us a call at our church office. That number is area code 330-875-2677. That is probably the two easiest ways that you can use to communicate with us. So if you're in Lewisville, in the Lewisville area, if there's anything that we can do for you, help you with, anything like that. I do want to sort of point you to something else. It has been, again, it's been an incredible week. There's been a lot of negative and negativity. If you've been watching the news, that would be one of the first things I'd say. Probably stay away from it for a little bit. It's probably all the same. But there's also been a lot of incredible good that has happened. And so I did want to point you to one project. We started off the week last Monday morning. We gathered with a number of city officials, pastors, the mayor, all of that, and we came up with a plan for how to reach and address the needs of kids while they're out of school. And we recognized that there is an incredible need to be able to help those who are not ready for this. And so we do have a project called Stuff the Barrel, and we are just, it's simply just a food drive. And this is all going to start tomorrow, Monday, March 23rd. And it's going to run through April 24th, and we're going to have a drop-off spot at the Lewisville Elementary School at door number 2, and it's going to be open from 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. We're going to have somebody out there taking donations, and really what we're looking for is just non-perishable stuff, a hamburger helper, canned box pastas, peanut butter jelly, spaghetti sauce noodles, things like that. Anything you can bring by and donate, we're going to be able to get that into the hands of our Lewisville Community Cupboard and some other local ministries and make sure that we disperse that stuff to where it needs to go. And so that is a very easy way. We have a number of people who have been asking, hey, what can we do to help? And while it's hard to sort of navigate all of that with, you know, how far can we go? You know, how close can we get to people? How can we do something without gathering? This is a very easy way for you to get involved. And so if you want to help with that, please consider just bringing by something during the day. If you need any more information for that, again, feel free to call the church office or send us an email. Hey, just a quick word about giving. First and foremost, our thanks to you for your continued support. These few weeks have certainly thrown us for a loop in terms of trying to maintain everything that we're doing on a weekly basis, trying to continue to minister to the families of Paradise Church and to Lewisville as a whole. We are going to encourage folks to look at some possible online options for giving. And so we have three ways to do that. The first, probably the easiest, is simply just go to our website, paradisechurch.org. On the website, on the top right-hand corner, there's a button that just simply says online giving. So if you follow that, that'll give you instructions for that as well. Another way that we have is we have a text option to give through text messages. So if you have your phone, if you want to send a text message to 330-295-2119. If you send a text message to that, you'll get a message back and there'll be instructions for you on how to give through that as well. The other thing is we have a church app. It's called Simple Church, and we use it frequently. And if you don't have that on your phone, we're going to encourage you to get that. And so the easiest thing to do is send us an email. Send us an email at info@paradisechurch.org, and I'll send you instructions on how to get that app. And so on that app, there's easy options for giving online, but it also has our church directory. It has our calendar, which everything's been canceled on it, but it's still there. But there's our church calendar is on there as well. There's different options for you to message individuals, send a message to a whole group. So if you had a whole group meeting and you want to send a quick message to say, hey, it's been canceled, rescheduled, things like that, that option is there for you. So do take advantage of that. Again, if you want to send us an email to info@paradisechurch.org, we will get you the instructions that you need to be able to put that on your phone. And if you have questions on anything, feel free to give us a call at the church office, 330-875-2677.
died for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do.
Seriously, as an important ministry that we do here at Paradise. And so we have a group that meets every Tuesday for prayer. We keep a very extensive list of all the needs and things that we are trying to remember. Again, just coming out of this week, it's a little overwhelming to sort of think about all the things that we've been normally keeping track of. And really that list has grown exponentially. Just the number of people, the doctors, the first responders, people that are feeling symptoms, schools, I mean, just, you know, all the things that are going on. We're trying our best to absorb that and process that. And so we're going to try to keep all of that stuff in our prayers as well. Again, if you have something specific that you want us to keep in mind, to add to our list, things like that, we're going to ask you to send us an email, and we'll be able to respond to that as well. But we do want to open up our service this morning with prayer. So if you'll bow with me in prayer. God, we do come to you. This is an extraordinary time, and even trying to find words has been difficult. God, we come to you. We ask you for peace. We ask you for us to have patience with one another, for us to learn and see what you have to say to us during this time and season. So God, I pray for those who are dealing with this illness directly. We pray for our nation, for our government, for our state and local and even national levels of leadership that you will guide us and navigate us through this season. God, we pray for your mercy. We pray for your healing. We pray for us to rest in your care. And all this we pray in your name. Amen.
Some of us learn lessons by being told, and some of us learn lessons by experiencing. And I'm the latter, more so, more often than not. And I wish it wasn't that way. Life would be easier if I could just learn by hearing instead of by doing, you know. And so here I was, probably 19 years old. You know, the world is my oyster. I can do whatever I want to do. And something inside me was saying, there's more. You know, there's more, there's something deeper, there's something more lasting, and even there's something more exciting. I remember actually being at a party one night and thinking, I want to go home so that I can get up tomorrow and go to church. I remember feeling like, why am I thinking that way right now? I got this girl inside, I'm pretty sure she wants to hook up. There's like a cooler full of super ice cold, just delicious beer is waiting for me over here. And I'm like, but actually, I actually want to go to church tomorrow. And it wasn't about like going to church and being religious. It was like, there was something else I wanted, you know? This idea of being connected to the divine, being connected to the creator of the universe. I had tasted that before, but I felt even beyond what I had experienced, there was something bigger, there was something more. And I remember during that period of time, I had started reading my Bible again and seeing all these miraculous things that happened and being like, I want to be that close to God because, dude, like, to know that the God of the universe is that close to me, that would be super cool. I want that. Yeah, the film The Heart of Man that I act in, there's this scene where the prodigal is about to walk off this cliff The guy's like totally blinded. We've all been there. We just have no idea what we're about to walk into. We see something that looks to us that's to be so good, and we're a bit blinded by our ambition. There's just something that's off, and we're just too blind to see it because we're too driven to where this thing we think is gonna bring us life. And here you have God portrayed by a loving father, and he's sitting there. He's not angry. He's passionately trying to woo him back with the violin and the music that represents friendship. So the father is never, he's not, you know, tackling the son or hitting him or calling him stupid. He's like, what are you doing, man? Don't you see where this is going to lead you? He's sitting there saying, dude, how about instead of going over there, I know it's not going to lead you where you want to be. I love you. Let's play catch instead. You know, he's always offering us this better yes. Even when we're blind, and, you know, I'm one of those guys, and we all do this at certain times. We all have to learn the hard way. We walk off the cliff, and it's not till later on we realize that actually wasn't what I wanted. And the father's sitting there saying, come sit with me. I can show you what it is you actually want. And that's been my life story for the last 17 years of him, me saying, all right, let me hear what you have to say. And him leading me very specifically down this path of all these things that are so much better than what I would have had for myself if I had just kept doing my own thing, you know. Jesus is not even the slightest amount intimidated by our questions or our brutal inward or outward ugliness or our like very intentional wrongdoings. Yeah, he's bigger than all that stuff. I now realize just how much he loves who I am and doesn't love me based on what I do. And that changes everything.
As we begin this morning, I don't know about you, but you know, I'm looking for an explanation. Maybe some of you are doing that as well. This has been an incredibly interesting week. I've never experienced anything like it. I don't think anyone else has either. And when we go through hard times, that's a lot of what people are looking for. They're looking for an explanation. Like, why did this happen? Why did this happen? Why did we go through this suffering? And so if you're watching this 10 years in the future, we're closing out our first real week of dealing with the coronavirus pandemic. And we've watched our schools close, we've watched sporting events canceled, restaurants have been closed, churches have been closed. We're really trying to stay somewhere under the recommended 10 people in a room. We're using a word that I never heard of, but two weeks ago, I would have not known what you meant by social distancing. And now it's the most important word around. And so we are washing hands and trying to sanitize, and everyone is taking precautions. Everyone is glued to the news, and one of the things that sort of arises from that is the idea of faith and belief and how all of that fits in. And so surprisingly, this text helps us to process it. It helps us to understand this whole idea of struggling with belief. And perhaps as you're watching this, you may have had a time in your life where you stepped away from faith because you couldn't explain it, because you couldn't wrap your mind around it. You needed to understand all of it in order to maintain it. And so this story, this sign that John uses is an incredible thing for us to be thinking about and meditating on this week. We've been in this series called Bystander, and we've been looking at the Gospel of John. And in John's Gospel, he has been using this idea of belief. He wants to point people to Jesus. He wants people to understand that Jesus is the Messiah. He is the Son of God, and he wants to use the seven signs. There's seven signs that Jesus that he does in the Gospel of John, and he wants to use those to point towards this idea of belief. The very thesis of John's Gospel is at the end of his Gospel. John chapter 20, verse 31 says, "These are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." And so again, John has these seven signs, and this is it's either the fifth or the sixth sign, no matter, depending on how you organize it. But when we look in the Gospel of John chapter 9, we come to this story, and it starts off, Jesus has been traveling. He's been going from place to place. And in this story, we have another situation where Jesus finds himself probably getting into trouble on the Sabbath day. And so John chapter 9 starts off. He says, "As he passed by, he saw a man blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, 'Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?'" And this was probably the typical understanding of the day. And when people were trying to explain pain and suffering, as we're trying to do today, 2,000 years ago, the general idea was that if somebody had something wrong with them, if they had a blindness, or they couldn't walk, or they had a skin disease, or something along those lines, the typical thought was they did something wrong, that they had sinned, or that their parents had sinned. There was a belief that if a woman was pregnant and she actually walked into a pagan temple, just by her doing that, that would cause something to be wrong with the child that was inside of her. So this was sort of the common thought. And so as they're passing by, they're probably looking back to Jesus. Maybe they're whispering to him. Maybe they don't want the blind man to hear this. But they're asking this common question. They want some explanation. And they have a pretty preconceived idea of what that answer is going to be. And so this is what they're looking for. And it was assumed. It was assumed that there was a connection. There was a connection between suffering. It was connected to our behavior of some kind. And as we sort of look through this week, it's sort of been weird. Most of that, you've had suffering. You've had things happen to you that were done to you by someone else. Someone else made a choice, and you suffered as a result of it. There have been times where I have made a choice, and that has brought pain and suffering upon someone else. But then there's this other sort of big category that doesn't fit into either one of those. That there are things that just happen. And I would say for most of us this week that we're all coming through sort of points us to that. And so Jesus' answer, he says, it was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. And it's this new category that John is recording, Jesus saying, that is mind-blowing. That pain actually can have a purpose. That the pain that I go through, the suffering that I go through, the pain that you go through, that it can actually be something that God can use. That God can actually work towards something as a result of it. As I said earlier in our announcements, it has been an amazing thing to sort of see how this community has been brought together. Faith leaders and city leaders and school officials, that was the first thing that was on our minds at the beginning of this week, is how can we help people? And I wouldn't have normally had that meeting. I wouldn't have had that scheduled. It wasn't sort of on my calendar. But it was just a cool thing that as soon as we started seeing the repercussions and how families were going to be affected, it was the thought of many to say, we need to do something to help people. I've also seen bad this week. I've seen people who have reacted very poorly to this. That they have taken this as a very personal thing, and they've spent their time sort of waving their hands and wondering why. And it's just sort of been an interesting sort of contrast that some people have reacted one way and people have reacted a different way. But what Jesus is saying, hey, there's something, there could be a purpose to this. There could be a reason. He continues in verse 4, he says, we must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And so he's like, what is he saying? He's saying, listen, while I'm here, I am the best example of what God wants to do in terms of suffering. While I'm here on earth, I want you guys to pay attention. Maybe he's telling Matthew and John, make sure you take notes. Because while I'm here, this is the best example. This is the best reflection of God the Father that I can show you. And so I want you to pay attention to what we are doing. He says in verse 6, having said these things, he spit on the ground and made mud with the saliva. Now this is just, it's just interesting. It's a little bit odd. We're not sure why he does this, but he spits on the ground, and that would not be favorable this week. Don't spit on the ground for anybody. But he spits on the ground, and he makes some mud, and he approaches the blind man. Now, the text does not help us a whole lot here. We don't get a whole lot of detail. We don't know if he tells him ahead of time. I guess the blind man can't see it, so he doesn't know exactly what's going on. But there's part of me that wants to know a little bit more about the detail that's going on here. But he says he made mud with saliva, but then he anointed the man's eyes with the mud. And it's interesting that he uses the word anointed here. That this was actually, it was a religious action. It was an act of holiness. It was not just a magic trick. He was not just trying to show off to impress people. But he steps in with this idea where he's going to do something that is just bizarre. In verse 7, verse 7, and said to him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. So he went and washed and came back seeing. And it's just an incredible story. I've had the opportunity, maybe you've seen some of these online. Every once in a while I'll stumble onto a YouTube video or a Facebook video where it's not necessarily somebody who's seeing for the very first time. The ones I've seen, though, there are these new glasses that you can get that they actually correct color blindness. That there are people who were not born blind, but they were born colorblind. They only see colors in a certain spectrum, and they'll put these glasses on, and they just sort of look around, and they're amazed, and it's just this incredible moment, and it's usually powerful. Usually they don't say a whole lot. They put these glasses on, and you can tell, though, they just start crying, and they get emotional. It's just an incredibly powerful thing. And the text doesn't give us a whole lot of these details. We don't know how much time passed. We don't know what happens as soon as this man can see. But you just have to imagine, just all of a sudden, his eyes are opened. And just what the whole concept of eyesight would have meant to this man. Going on to verse 8, it says, the neighbors of those who had seen him before, as a beggar, were saying, is this not the man who used to sit and beg? Some said, it is he. Others said, no, but he is like him. And there's probably some disagreement. There's probably like, is that the guy? Is that the guy? Is that blind Joe we see? Is that? No, that can't be him. He looks like him. That must be his cousin or something like that. But they were just really just trying to figure this out. They were trying to understand what they had seen. The whole time, though, as the text continues, he kept saying, I am the man. I am that guy. So he said to him, then how were your eyes open? He answered, the man called Jesus made mud and anointed my eyes and said to me, go to Siloam and wash. So I went and washed and received my sight. They said to him, where is he? He said, I don't know. And that's kind of, you got to think about it, it's kind of humorous. You know, of course the blind man wouldn't have seen where Jesus went. And what happens is Jesus basically, he is telling this man to do something that we are all told to do. This man, when he puts the mud on this gentleman's eyes, he is instructing him, as we are all instructed to do, I want you to go and do something, even though you can't see it. Even though you can't see it at the time, he's in telling him to do something, just like he's telling us to do something. There are many times where I have been asked or told to do something that I did not see the result, that I did not see where it was all going. But this man listens and he obeys. And then you can sort of imagine there's sort of a tone change. I want you to sort of imagine that the music changes a little bit. When you get to verse 13, it says, they brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Dun, dun, dun. So the Pharisees come in, and all of a sudden this story takes a hard left turn, where it is this amazing miracle story. This man that was once blind, now he can see. Now the Pharisees come in, and again you sort of have this debate. Now we've been seeing over the last few weeks, this has sort of been the modus operandi for the last few chapters, where Jesus will have this ongoing discussion, this ongoing debate with the Pharisees. And again, what has happened is, as verse 14 tells us, now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Like, oh man, it's on Sabbath day again. Again, this just happened in the last few chapters. We see this going on, where Jesus is like, you know, can't you figure this out? Don't do it on the Sabbath. You can do it on a Monday or Tuesday, but he doesn't seem to want to listen. So in verse 14, it says, now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. So the Pharisees again asked him how he had received his sight. And he said to them, he put mud on my eyes, and I washed, and I see. Some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. But others said, how can a man who is a sinner do such things? And what's going on here is again, there's sort of this preconceived notion that people have brought to the story. And maybe you have a preconceived notion. Maybe you, when you walked away from faith years ago, you had something happen to you that did not fit into the box that you had made for yourself. Maybe something happened, maybe a tragedy happened, maybe you lost a loved one, maybe you lost a job, maybe there was something that you had yourself sort of go on the off-ramp and you really could not get yourself back on. And that's where these Pharisees are. The Pharisees, they have this sort of idea of a holy man should do this, a man sent from God should do this, and if he does anything outside of that, then it doesn't fit. Maybe we're all in that situation. Maybe some of us are feeling that this week. So they're arguing amongst each other. You know, if he was a holy man, he wouldn't have done this on the Sabbath, but how can someone who's not a holy man do these actions? So they said again to the blind man, what do you say about him, since he has opened your eyes? He said, he is a prophet. He really didn't have a whole lot to say. I don't know a whole lot about this guy. I don't know what all was going on. I don't know where this man has been. I don't know what all he has done. I was just sitting there, and this man came up, and he put this mud on my eyes, and now I can see. So of course he's a prophet. Of course there's something special about him. Verse 18, the Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight. And they asked them, is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he now see? So they call the parents. The parents come in. They're all probably trying to catch, they're probably trying to find their bearings on this whole story. They're probably looking at, like, oh my gosh, that's our son, and now he can see, but now they're getting peppered with questions. I mean, it is sort of a chaotic thing. And again, I sort of think about just sort of all the noise that we have gone through this week with news reports and politics and all the things that are sort of swirling around. It's just sort of been this chaotic thing. His parents answered, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind. But how he now sees, we do not know, nor do we know who opened his eyes." And then the parents continue to say, "Ask him. He is of age. He will speak for himself." He was old enough. He was old enough to speak in court. He was old enough to be a witness. He was old enough to have his own opinions. And so the parents, they were trying to back away a little bit. They did not want to be caught in the middle of this. Because the text tells us, there's something interesting that John puts in. He says, his parents said these things because they feared the Jews. For the Jews had already agreed that if anyone should confess Jesus to be the Christ, he was to be put out of the synagogue. So basically, what the parents were saying is that we don't want to get involved because it is already something that we know. You have already made up your mind. And so this is where many of us might be. Maybe you've already made up your mind. If you go through your life, you're going to have something called confirmation bias, where if you believe in God, if you have a belief that has been with you for your life, you're going to find things that are going to reaffirm that. If you have some reason to not believe in God, to not believe in Jesus, you are going to find things that are going to constantly reaffirm that. And what his parents were basically saying, well, look, I already know you've already made up your mind. You've already made up your mind. Some of you have already made up your mind in terms of faith or not believing, really based on this week. The things that you've gone through this week are going to reaffirm to you the things that you already know to be true. In verse 24, "So for the second time they called the man who had been blind and said to him, 'Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner.'" Verse 25, "He answered, 'Whether he is a sinner, I do not know.'" And this is probably one of the most amazing lines in all of Scripture that weren't said by Jesus or a prophet. But he says, "One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see." And that's probably where a lot of us are. That's probably where a lot of us are. You don't have to have everything explained. That is really the heart of it. A lot of the time, we are only given so much knowledge. And you don't have to have every explanation given to you. There are many things I look at this week that I really can't explain. Why did this happen? Why did this happen at this season? You know, as a minister, we're getting ready to go into Easter. We're looking at the prospect of having really services canceled throughout the whole month of April. And I could get really kind of worked up about that and say, okay, man, why is this happening? But with this man, what this man says, he says something powerful. He says, I don't know everything. I don't know everything. I don't know who this guy was. I don't know anything about him. All I know is this, is that I at one point could not see, and now I can. It's powerful. And so as we continue through this chapter, verse 26, it says, "They said to him, 'What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?' He answered them, 'I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become one of his disciples?'" And that sent them over the edge. They just sort of lost their minds after that. And they sort of push this guy. They basically run him out of the temple. They don't want to hear anything else. They don't want to hear any other comments, any other opinions. They don't want to participate. They're really doing there's a term called willful blindness. Willful blindness. Not just that you can't see, but that you choose not to see. That once you made up your mind, once you got to a certain point in your life, that you refused to continue looking. That you refused to see the things that were really out there for you to see. That at some point you had developed this box, and your view, your belief, your faith in God or or belief in no God, that you have sort of gotten this thing worked out, and you're not letting any other evidence enter in. And it's this chapter, it's this story that really pushes us. It's this week that has really been pushing me. Perhaps God is bigger than you thought he was. Perhaps God is bigger than you thought he was. Perhaps I've been wrong. Perhaps you've been wrong. It is okay, not to know everything. It is okay to have, a belief that is simply based on experience. Say, hey, listen, I can't explain all the stuff in Genesis 1. I can't explain creation and evolution. I can't explain all of that. All I know is this, is that I was in a dark place. I was in a place where I needed some life change. I needed something to happen to me. And I started going to church. I started getting involved in a small group. I started getting back into reading the Bible. I started doing some things that reawakened something in me. There was an experience that I went through. And I was in this dark place, and now I'm not there anymore. Can I explain all of it? No, I can't explain all of it. But all I know is that what it has done for me. There are tons of things that you know that you can't explain. No one can explain this whole coronavirus thing. But you can't explain anything else. You can't explain love. You can't explain energy. You can't explain how cells work. No one can explain how this little virus is causing all this havoc. There's lots of things that we don't doubt and we don't discount simply because we can't explain it. But again, as we sort of close out, as John closes out his gospel in chapter 20, verse 31, he again points to by saying, believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. What John wants to do through this story, through each one of the signs, is he says, listen, all I'm telling you is this is what I saw. This is what I experienced. This is what I was a witness to. And I want you to take that story. I want you to take these things that I am recounting to you. And I want you to come to belief as a result of that. These are the things that I want you to see. And this is sort of where it starts to get to the apex in the Gospels. We get into the next few weeks. There's a lot of momentum that really pushes us towards Palm Sunday and the crucifixion, resurrection. This is sort of where it's starting to get to this point. This is this major point that John wants to make. With this little story, just this little story of this blind man, he wants to make sure you understand. You have a chance to believe. You can look at the stuff that is here, or you can choose to be blind to it. I hope, as you continue through this week, that you will take the opportunity to re-examine. Take the opportunity to maybe look at what this story says, what the text says, and compare it maybe to something you were told as a child. Maybe you're sort of wrestling with that your version of faith isn't really lining up with what you grew up with. Or maybe there was something that happened in your life that you sort of turned away. All you have to do is at this point be just like this man and say, you know what, I don't know all of it, but I do know that I can see. And I hope that is the case for all of us. Let's pray. God, we thank you. God, we thank you for all the things that you have put in front of us, all the things that we can look at and easily assess that you are here in our lives. God, there are so many things that I could point to that could lead me towards the route of disbelief. But there's so much more that I can point to say, no, it is very clear. Not only is there a God, but there is a God who loves me. And in the midst of this season, God, we thank you for sending your Son to die for us on a cross, to take away our sins. God, all of this is for that purpose. And so, God, I pray for each of us as we continue through this week, as we continue to see things that we wouldn't have believed weeks ago. that through this we would continue to see you, and that we put our faith, we put our belief in you and what you've done for us. And all this we pray in your name. Amen. Thank you so much for being with us this week. We're going to be in this same format at least through next Sunday. Again, we're not sure what April will bring, but we'll keep you updated week after week. If there's anything you need, again, please feel free to contact us at the church. You can send us an email. You can call the church office. But we do pray for everyone who's hearing this. We pray that you would have a safe week, that you would have a great opportunity to reconnect with those who are in your household. If you have kids, I pray that they don't drive you crazy. But we want you to have as good of a time as you possibly can. If you know anybody that would be interested or needs this, feel free to share this with them. Point them to our website. Maybe they need to hear some words of comfort this week as well. So we hope that you have a wonderful week. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.